to smile, to take a photograph for the guys back home. It's very weird to be back in Sal A. It's quite eerie. I think it's quite normal to have recurrent dreams of not finishing your study. I see I. Graafland, and I'm kind of worried about if I did hear these tests okay or not, or whether I actually delivered them. So I'm nervous. This is part of the team. I must say I'm quite surprised that we are invited in a conference about theory, because we don't do much theory. We're not very good at it. We used to have Mark Linneman, and he was very much inclined to get into it in the early 90s. But recently he left the office to become a developer of all things. So things might go the other way. You see the office. Of course, architects are dressed in black. When the dean changed in Berlage Institute, I think a quite interesting question was asked. What is an architect? Since I was educated in Delft, I kind of had no clue. And since then, I've been trying to figure out. And I must say that at first, I was really super skeptical about what an architect actually can do. Architecture is a reactive discipline. Architects seem to lack the imagination or the courage to actually initiate. Architects don't run the risks. So, if we don't develop into developers, how can we become proactive or do stuff? So, what I try to do for today is make kind of a list of things that we did, and I have to run a marathon in 1 hour, so the fatigue might kick in soon. So we can combine the existing into new configurations. That's what we tried with kind of a 3D logo for the way we work in our office. You see three archetypal vases in the front row. They can contain flowers, of course. What we did is merge them, bring them together into a singular object. Horrifically ugly or smashingly beautiful, but totally uncontrollable, but always containing enough water to hold a bouquet. And it's better to not have too much water, your local florist can tell you. We can remix reality. This is an image we made, I think, mid-90s, that could be explained as a desire, but was initiated as a kind of form of, you could say, critique. In our office, we were really afraid of the decline or the transformation of the inner cities into theme parks only. And as a sort of result of that, we eventually made a parking garage that we hoped could sort of fertilize economic activity in the core of old downtowns. We can offer alternatives. This is in the Netherlands how the suburbs are treated. People really desire to live in a house with a garden where the kids can play. As you see, there's no garden. So by kind of really simply remixing the ingredients of road and row house, we can liberate incredible amounts of ground. You can see in this diagram, we can gain 26% by making the roof accessible and arrange all the parking on top. And as a consequence, everybody can park two cars, which is much more than regulations allow you until today. So it becomes much more generous in two ways. So for the kids, they can play in the green, you can have a private garden, and you can have parking in front of the door. Another trick is sort of reuse in a kind of vulgar way a logo, and sort of by combining additional meaning, totally transforming it into a new object that might be completely incomprehensible. Kind of out of control. At the moment we're doing a project with Studio Hetzberger, one of the great teachers here. It's called the Crossover Hall. It's part of a 3D urbanism that is coordinated by Hetzberger, and about four additional halls for pop music or jazz, chamber music will be kind of assembled on Hetzberger's masterpiece in Utrecht. Our invention here is that the hole, which has to sort of kind of feed into both the jazz hole and the pop music hole, as you can see here, there's a link and there's a link here. But what we kind of discovered is that this box-in-box principle, by kind of making it slightly more spacious, you could include in this principle the infrastructure. So by pumping up the cavity or using the airspace, we could include the programmatic functions, additional functions within that system of the box-in-box idea. You can also tidy up in a square in Dordrecht that we make with DS Landscape Architects. Sort of halfway finished now. The grass is not there, the orange is not there, the playgrounds are not there. We try to kind of resolve the dilemma of programming public space in a way that you can actually use it, but still leaving it completely open for everybody. So there was no box around it that you usually see in playgrounds, kind of shielding it off from public space, but we tried to keep it open. What we proposed was the car wash fountain. All the neighborhood people were incredibly enthusiastic about it, but not in their neighborhood, because they thought it would attract the wrong people and sort of traffic jams of people waiting for the fountain. The thing that will go completely unnoticed, but I think that's one of the capacities that you can have as an architect, is to reorganize a kind of given conditions into maybe better organization. So simple, by reorganizing stuff you can do better, and in that sense we can make, by only creating perpendicular parking instead of parallel, we can create a much better working square, much more accessible and much more open. We can do stuff with containers, like good architects, you have to do something with containers at some point in your career. Loop-the-loop is a stand for a building site. That's, I think, something that only happened in Amsterdam. Since there are so many construction sites, people tend to get annoyed. But the government is so concerned with its inhabitants and its voters, of course, that they wanted to turn it into a new kind of spectacle. So even the government in Amsterdam, or kind of cultural institutions, try to bend the negative, sort of the construction side that's always blocking your way, into something positive. And of course they opened a small competition and we were part of that. Our proposal was to use regular shipping containers, and by bisecting them, joining them, they could be assembled in numerous ways. It could be taken apart again and be assembled in, again, different ways. So we had five containers to start with, and the black pieces is the residual that we didn't use. you get this kind of inhabitable kind of weird cave that you could use for exhibitions, but also as a kind of viewpoint to overlook the building site. We can reinforce the public. For a small competition in Budapest, where the assignment was to make a small building on the bank of the river, we thought that maybe architecture could do more than sit on a bank, and we proposed to make some sort of a inhabitable bridge. And since our office is next to a bridge and it opens all the time, it kind of was the inspiration for a building that could be, let's say, 9 distinct, completely different versions for the price of one. So, from, let's say, a connector, it could be transformed into an island, to provide sun shading. This would be the ultimate moment for the conference. Even Rem Koolhaas would not be able to get out of the building. Also, we can go nuts. For a Mandarina Duck store in Paris, in a terrible hangover, we came up with we could not do anything else but come up with good ideas. And because the emptiness of hangover creates the space for radical inventions, in this case, it's a slowly rotating spiral stair. It's completely brain dead because it doesn't help you to get up. It only kind of reinforces the idea that in the second floor, still more goods are available. And this is one of the rare stores where actually the turnover in the second level is higher than in the, let's say, the street level. And the stair might have something to do with it. What interested us is that it became, by slowly moving, it became kind of a symbol, for the enhanced symbol of itself. Something we can do is rewrite the manual. This is a regular, we call it a strap, a thing you can buy for €1 to fix stuff on your bike. Most of you might know it. The only thing we changed is the color, and we rewrote a manual for it. So now it becomes a product. We added intelligence, and in your local museum shop you can buy it now for €16. That's quantifiable, and in a way the original guy that designed this thing at the moment is suing us and Ralph Design for taking his idea, but it's a weird thing that we're not resolved yet, so we're actually losing money on it at the moment. You can boost content. What you see here is a regular gallery lighting connected to a computer that has access to internet, and the gallery lighting can be used as a kind of building size billboard. So it's not an additional thing. It's basically reusing part of the hardware that's already there. You can fuse functions. We can amalgamate the program, actually. For a recent competition in the north of Amsterdam for the new film museum that we didn't win, because De Lugan Meisel won with a faceted object that in its play with motion and light resembled movie making. You cannot beat that. We came up with that phrase, of course, before as well. But thought, no, this is too corny. But somehow, design intelligence plus sort of commercial rap really helped. What we were interested in here is already embedded in the whole institution. The fact that it is a film museum, which is actually a cinema plus exhibition spaces. And we were really thrilled by the idea that by kind of making a folded square on which the 4 cinemas that were required can sit, and kind of over-dimensioning this, kind of an informal cinema could come into being. So you can use the slot for all kinds of more individual or collective ways of watching movies that you can sort of get from the database, and it would create hopefully an incredible mix between what you already know about going to the movies and what you already know of going to a museum, and by fusing it a new reality might come into being. The competition we lost because they had a second phase and they asked a couple of questions, and we were allowed to say what we thought about it in three sheets of A4, and we used all of it while the others decided to answer yes and no, and somehow that really appealed to the Rijksbouwmeester. Hopefully we can catalyze urban life. This is a small pavilion for a kind of a youth activity center in the west of Amsterdam. We kind of lifted it, such providing a place where young people could actually hang out. And also, this is exactly the reason why we lost it, because the local alderman was afraid that young people might hang out there. And one of the features besides the cell phone cell, which is the element over here where you can sort of talk on your cell phone in privacy, and because you can sort of slip into a cell, is the patio, the court, with a half pipe. So the skaters can be right in the center of the building without being able to access it. You can also try to reveal beauty. One of the sort of media that we use a lot is Photoshop, but this one, I can tell you, we hardly did any Photoshopping. We changed the color of the tree slightly, and we added the word camping here at the cursor, but that's all we did. And for us, mid-90s, this was a way to express that the only place called ghetto in the Netherlands, the Bijlmermeer, actually had an incredible intrinsic beauty that we maybe should come to love somehow, or at least try to appreciate it. After the airplane flew in, the local government decided that maybe the entire thing should be replaced with mediocrity and regular Phoenix housing. So that's the way in which in the Netherlands problems are attacked. We basically replace the bad stuff that where the poor people live, and then convert it into sort of middle class paradise, and everybody's happy. You can explore the limit, bend the roof. In the embassy, you know that the legislation or the rules and the law of the mother country actually apply. Which opens up the opportunity for a coffee shop in Berlin. From a frustration with the lack of imagination with cruise ships, we came up with a suggestion of an alternative, and we hope at the same time that by kind of adding value or character to the cruise ships, who of course in itself are already wonderfully beautiful, but still if they sort of dock in a city, basically what they do is parasite on the whole city. What we hope for is a more kind of reciprocal relationship in which people that are in the city could actually somehow benefit from the fact that the ship sails in and brings a certain kind of program, sales program into the city that you can enjoy for a while. You can protect. This is a small building for a soccer club in Utrecht. It's under construction now. Shunt screens that could be folded in and as such can hopefully serve as a form of protection for vandalism. We can conceal. Another small building in Amsterdam, it's a restaurant pavilion. Our client asked us to make a pavilion in which a house would be hidden in the roof. He didn't want anybody to know, basically also because of regulations, that there would be a house. So by kind of making the section intelligent, sort of have a sort of low area in the center of the pavilion that provides intimacy and at the same time allows a small in the six meter height of the section allows the house to sit within that height and at the same time kind of opening up to the sides and to the quite wonderful environment. The building can perform exactly in the way the client hopes. We can explore proximity for West Kowloon competition that was won by Foster but is recently cancelled. We propose to, in all the sort of artificial wonderfulness of Hong Kong, to add a ski slope to the already existing entertainment industry, where you find, of course, a lot of shopping malls that are combined with skating rinks, ice skating rinks, and so on. So it's not a foreign thing to Hong Kong. So the ski slope would kind of connect all kinds of additional program, like cultural facilities, like theater, museum, cinemas, shopping, etc. It would be a backbone for kind of a completely new experience. And by flipping the Hong Kong model of a sokkel or a base with towers on it, we could create an interesting canopy. At this moment we're involved with the reconfiguration of part of the renewable energy of the Netherlands. There's a lot of space required for a new generation of windmills. What we're at the moment, or at least my partners and colleagues are doing at the moment, because they're working at it right now, almost streaming video, we're trying to reinvent, let's say, the image of what a windmill can be. So instead of a kind of a visually polluting thing, it could become, hopefully, something that in its grandeur or interesting shape could become somewhat maybe heroic, or maybe you could develop an affective relation with it. You can solve problems. In the Netherlands, there's 2,500 kilometers of highway, and it's projected that by 2020 or so, 50,000 new hectares of business area are necessary. In a very funny way, in the Netherlands, all the new business areas are along highways, and this is considered a problem because it kind of obstructs the open view. You don't have a kind of hardway view that you might want, or you don't experience the open landscape while still behind the walls of all these sort of shiny boxes, the landscape is still open. So this could be a new chart. It's purple with red and yellow. That could be prime location indication on the map. You see there's a derivative of the traffic intensity in the Netherlands. What we proposed is to think about ways in which you can kind of compact this thing, and it's relatively simple. So by sort of elevating the freeway, and we calculated that it only needs to be like 12 meter high, you can already see the entire contour of this new bulk of business area. So if you would kind of make, let's say, point city of new business areas, you would only need to lift the highway about 12 meters. And we think that this is the kind of thing that you can bring as an architect, is that you're from this kind of two-dimensional system of walls around along the highway, you can make much more interesting configurations like kind of relatively simple transformation. We can invent ecologies. While we're doing that research, we discovered that illegal street races are incredibly popular in the Netherlands, but also considered a problem in a way, because sometimes they die and stuff like this. And we discovered that they always happen on derelict or deserted business areas. So what we thought is if we combine this kind of quarter mile capacity or kind of circuit-like outfit for the street racers, it could double as a kind of a parkway for the business area. And we hope that there could be some sort of mutual benefit. But one thing that we've been trying a lot is to extend the brief, and to do that by proposing additional program. In our first building, the heat transfer station in Utrecht, a rubber clad building, we tried to convince the client that eventually this building would be part of public space, and that eventually it would be the village square that would be wrapped around the box. Basically, there's a machine in there, nothing else. They asked us to design the skin, but we kind of hoped that we could activate the facade. We could not do anything about the content, but we're left to the skin. So, in principle, it was an unmanned installation. It was our first building, and we really hoped for some form of inhabitation. So, as such, the skin is programmed. Sports, nature, and information. Climbing grips. And the transparent backboard that serves as the only window in the building. The drain pipe and some nests for birds. So it's an ecological building. It actually won the ecological prize of the city of Munich. But so far the birds that we intended the the holes in the corniche core still didn't discover the building. So the ecologist says it can take more than 10 years before they know where their new nest is. So fingers crossed, about 2 or 3 more years to go. Also in the case of the basketball, the court was not part of the initial assignment. So it's an addition to the program, and it serves, I think, numerous purposes, and one of which is that it basketball really serves as a kind of it radiates in a way through video clips, advertisement, and whatever, what have you. It radiates urban life, and the campus in Utrecht was kind of really in desperate need for that. What we did is basically extend the existing bookstore. We thought it was wonderfully, elegantly detailed and very sweet. And so our first intuition, it looked like this, was to make more of this. And why not a fish? No, because we love this structure. And by making more of it, it could provide a basketball pitch on the roof. And because it was so low, we had to solve the problem that by not sort of disconnecting the roof, we had to find a solution to make a grand cafe out of it, to make the floor to ceiling space higher. So instead of making the roof higher, we dug a hole in the ground, and the hole is exactly 1.20 meters deep, which equals the height of the fountain, the bar, and it means that all the window sills are potentially extension of the bar. You enter over the counter. But because we lowered the floor of the bar, we need to make an entrance to the disabled. This is the son of my partner making a test drive. And the ramp develops into a kind of arena where people can sort of drink coffee and hang out and smoke cigarettes. And as such, it's a kind of incredibly large ashtray. And since it's kind of carved out from the public space, it of course completely fills up with trash anyways. And so some of the sort of software of this project is the fact that there's a contract between the bar owner and the people that run the campus, that this guy every day he cleans the public space. And I think this is the kind of intelligence that maybe you don't have to sort of come up with it as an architect, but you have to sort of surround yourself with people that can come up with these kinds of small innovations, because you know that if it was just the public space, it would be completely a failure. But by kind of tweaking the software that runs this place, it might work. And so far, it's kind of okay. And the disabled ramp doubles as a skate ball, and some completely unexpected use. One sort of serious problem that we saw ourselves confronted with is the chimney. We had no clue how to deal with the smoke vent. And luckily, we over-dimensioned the pipes that keep up the net, because we didn't want any diagonals in our building to distort the image in a kind of technical thing. So we wanted to keep the building simple. This over-dimensioning allowed us to put all the ventilation and so on in these pipes. Another way to establish the relation between the playground and the bar, again, I think a moment of brilliance in a terrible hangover, is the transparent middle circle. I think I will leave it at this. Look at it.